Thank you everyone for coming out both in person and on Zoom for our very first 2020-2021 Arts and Lecture Series event. Thanks to Ryan, our student president, Jill, and the provost office for their technological support. It's fitting that we have a locally grown citizen, Andy Diaz, here tonight to kick off our lecture series for the year, as we are exploring the question of what it means to be a good citizen. Andy grew up in Peoria, where his father repaired bikes and planted gardens, teaching his son the importance of building community. After being transferred to different cities as an account manager at Caterpillar, Andy and his family returned to Peoria in 2016. Instead of heading out to the suburbs where the realtor kept suggesting, he headed back to his old neighborhood on the near north side of Peoria. Since then, he's founded Urban Acres, which bought up empty lots to grow fresh produce, and the Springboard Market, which allows for the sale of that produce, as well as giving other local vendors the opportunity to sell their wares. His experiences with Urban Acres and Springboard Market have led him to announce his candidacy in the Peoria mayoral election that will happen in spring 2021. Tonight, he's here to tell his story, which he calls From Gardens to Government. Please help me welcome Andy Diaz.
Thank y'all very much. I appreciate it. It's awesome to be invited to speak to you. And it's funny, as my wife and I were coming over this evening, we started talking about the whole invite and the lecture series. And I was just going over the speech, and she's heard it a couple of times. But then we started arguing about the definition of citizenship. So I'm tossing out the opening half of the speech to really say, I had the definition of citizenship and that it's the implications of freedom and accompanying responsibilities and all this, and going into Webster and Britannica and all this. And my wife said, get over it. It's about being involved. It's about being invested. It's about being part of a community and a greater good. And I hope that as you hear my story tonight, you understand maybe the actions I've taken to be a better citizen, and that as a family that we do to be citizens in Peoria, but that it inspires you to take some small steps along the way to be a citizen yourself. You see, I'm a first generation American. My mom's family was migrant workers back in the 40s and 50s. Every winter, my family would be in Mexico, and in the spring, they'd come up to central Illinois and to the Midwest, and they would work the crops. My grandpa walked beans, he detasseled, he followed the sugar beets. And then in about the mid-50s, he moved the family up for that year's harvest, and they were actually the first Hispanic or Mexican family to settle in the Bloomington-Normal area. And this was when they were claiming our citizenship here in central Illinois. Now, on my dad's side, I'm gonna let you know a little known fact. My dad was a rule breaker. He comes from a family of 12 kids in the heart of Mexico in a small town called Tlaltenango. It's a real tongue twister. But there he was one of the older children in this family of 12, and they were in a family where in such poverty that literally family was dying of starvation. My dad would sit there and tell us stories about my grandpa renting him out at the age of 6 to go work the sugar cane crops and the peanut crops to help make extra money for the family and to feed his siblings. My dad saw an opportunity to help his family by coming to the United States to make money and to send it home and to support the rest of his family. It's always fun to talk to my dad about his coming to the U.S. because it took him to finally make it over the border and get into the country. And at that point, he was loaded into the back of a U-Haul truck, scores of other people, shoulder to shoulder with a 5-gallon bucket in between them for the use of facilities. Because when you've got a truck full of not stopping at a local rest area to unload everyone to use the bathroom. After a long road trip, he made it to Chicago, and it was there that he connected with some other folks from his village here in Illinois. And he was lucky enough to meet one guy who told him to come to Central Illinois because there was somebody who would help him find a job. So he got here as quick as possible to start making money and sending it back home. He met my mom, he got legal, they got married, and then they moved to Peoria and had two kids, my brother Felipe and I. Now, I give you all that detail first because it's an integral part of my story, how I made it into this world. Second, it plays a large part in who I am, my own works and my heritage, not just as a citizen of the United States, but as Andres Diaz and my connections with my family and my history. So I grew up in Peoria in the 80s. I was maybe one of 10 Latino families in the school that I was at. We lived in what we have now branded as the North Valley. But to many back in the day, it was just the North End or the Hood, depending on where you lived. And as kids, my parents did all they could to provide for us and to send money back to our family. Every Christmas, we loaded up the car and we drove 36 hours to my dad's village in Mexico. It was awesome, for as much as it sounds horrible to be in the car for 36 hours. But I learned the stories of our family, the tall tales to the real life. We talked about poverty. We talked about growing up and only getting broth to eat, or that stale old hard tortilla. And I kind of relate that to the story that most people in the United States hear about grandpa walking uphill both ways through the snow, right? It's that Mexican version, but both ways are ways to tell you of how much better you have it today than our predecessors had it. And that was my dad's way of letting us know of the greatness we had it here living in the United States. Because all those trips to Mexico were trips to see family that had nothing. But it instilled a value of family in me because we would show up from the United States and every aunt, uncle, and cousin would spend 2 or 3 weeks of every day meeting up with us, taking us sightseeing, taking us through the village, taking us shopping, and just showing us what family is. And it was a couple weeks at Christmas, a few weeks in the summer, or other holidays, and I was connected with my family culture. You help a cousin, you help a friend, you help a neighbor out when you can, because as a community, you have to take care of each other, and you have to see that the local safety nets that maybe we're used to here in the United States aren't present elsewhere, specifically not in Mexico. And the idea of citizenship as a member in a community, taking care of others, that was instilled into me in my life, in my childhood, by my parents and my family. When my folks bought their home in Peoria, they got into a very blue-collar neighborhood. In the 70s and 80s, Caterpillar had tons of factories in what is now the Costco and Target footprint in East Peoria. And most of the folks that work at those factories were living in my neighborhood. And then in the early 80s, there was a huge strike. There was families that were displaced from work and were impacted greatly by Caterpillar's choices of what they were doing in manufacturing. Fortunately, my dad worked for the railroad at the time, so we didn't have a true impact, but I saw the impact in Peoria, in my neighborhood. When you went over to your friend's house and you saw his parents arguing about money when they hadn't paid bills in months because they weren't making but a couple $100 in strike benefits, it was daunting. It was a challenge. But I remember my parents having all the cookouts and the picnics and the amount of potlucks that we had in the neighborhood because it was community rallying around each other. It was taking care of your fellow citizen and not putting each other to shame, but understanding that the struggle is real with all of us and that together we can work things out and at least get through some of the hard times. As jobs came open, as marriages broke up, our friends left the neighborhood and it started to collapse. The vibrancy was gone, but my parents still remained. For me, I went to the local public school. I was fortunate enough that I was admitted to Washington Gifted School in my fourth grade year. Now, let's just say my admittance into that school was a culture shock. It blew my nine-year-old mind to see the other children in the community. Because you see, up until that point in my life, I had a dad who went to work each day clean and came home tired, exhausted, and dirty as all get out from a hard day's work. And like my dad, the other people around us in the community, they were laborers. That was what I saw. But when I got into Washington, I was exposed to kids whose parents were doctors and lawyers and engineers, and they came home as clean as they left the house in the morning. And they lived in great places like Grandview Drive and the Knolls. Those were places that were foreign to me. I didn't even understand what it was like to be in those neighborhoods because my only reference point was television shows like Silver Spoons. So it was a world away from where I lived, but it exposed me to the idea that if I used education and my brain to move ahead, that I could have a better life through working with my brain and not my body. Now, the opposite was true of my peers at that school. They weren't coming into the hood, and the closest thing that they had exposure, again, was television. So you fast forward to high school at Woodruff, which is an economically challenged, culturally diverse school, and the kids from Washington wanted nothing more than to be my friend to make sure that they survived their freshman year of high school. And I began to bridge gaps between the kids that I went to grade school with, the haves, and a lot of the kids that were in my neighborhood that I played with after school, the have-nots. And I made people part of our extended family. And conversely, I became a part of theirs. I remember being exposed to all sorts of things that without living in both worlds, I never would grow to appreciate. And I had a lot going for me and I recognized it. I had teachers that were pushing me to be better, parents that encouraged me to be active. In high school, I was part of the orchestra, sports, speech, student council. I ate up the opportunity to experience the life that my dad provided for me by leaving Mexico to come to the United States. In my junior year of high school, it was an honor and awesome to help my dad become a U.S. citizen. I remember helping him through all the governmental questions and learning a new appreciation for our own government and the status that I was given by birth. While many will say that their dad's the best or their hero, when I say it because he taught me how to take care of my family and our community, to be a good citizen, and to live a life as an example of citizenship. Following my high school graduation, I went off to college. For the sake of brevity and maybe an invitation to come back in the future about a speech on perseverance, I received my bachelor's degree 10 years after graduation, making me the first Diaz to have a college degree. In my 20s, I was blessed to have a job with the Regional Planning Commission. I started counting cars, and after 6 years there, was using computer skills I learned in grade school to do GIS work, geographic information systems for the region. I was working besides urban planners, public works professionals, elected officials, and public administrators from throughout the region. It was work that paid decently and gave me an opportunity to buy my first home. Now, this may not surprise you, but I bought there in my neighborhood. And it gave me an opportunity to go to work and then come home And whether it was fixing up my $8,000 house or bikes from kids in the neighborhoods to get them back out and playing, I was following in the footsteps of my father, who lived those values of taking care of your neighbor. This way of living provided a great opportunity for me, and it brought accolades along the way. From the Peoria JC's Good Citizen of the Year to the City of Peoria's Good Neighbor Award, I was putting myself out there in public and getting rewarded in turn. Being active and engaged in the community presented opportunities for me, which is what happened 16 years ago when, following a public meeting where I had discussed GIS, a gentleman came up to me and said, "Have you ever considered working for Caterpillar?" And I said, "No, not really. I'm pretty happy where I'm at." He goes, "Well, I'm guessing as a Latino, you speak Spanish?" I was like, "Yeah, I speak okay Spanish. I actually speak better French." And his jaw kind of dropped and didn't know what to think. But he said, "Can I get your resume?" And I said, "No, I'm all good, man. Thank you, though, very much." I had seen what Caterpillar had done to people around me. When he told me what the starting salary was, I really quick went and put together a new resume and got it to him. So it was a time to change career paths and recognize that I was awarded an opportunity to do more in my life. And again, to build off the idea of my dad coming to this country to sacrifice so that we would get ahead. Caterpillar moved me from Peoria to Dallas, Texas, to Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, and allowed me to check my passport in Brazil, India, Thailand, around the world, places that my parents could only dream of. I've been to. Along the way, I met a wonderful woman, Catherine, who, despite being out of my league and just agreed to marry me. And along the way, we've been blessed with 4 children, 3 boys and a little girl, and they are our true treasures. And for her, she was from a small bubble in West Lafayette, Indiana. So she didn't have any misconceptions about Peoria. She just had what people told her. And when we had the opportunity 5 years ago to move back, she said, "We're not moving into the neighborhood." And it kind of hurt me, but I understood, right? It was what people had told her and conditioned her. So we bought a nice place and checked all the professional boxes that you have as an urban young professional. Nice home, check. School system, check. Picket fence, we had it all. But it wasn't offering fulfillment. And truly, I didn't feel engaged in my community. Now, 2 things changed, and 2 stories came about that helped reset my direction. You see, every Sunday, we would come into Peoria and we'd go to a church. And afterwards, we would hang out at my folks' house and spend the afternoon, have dinner, and then head back 25, 30 minutes to our house in Metamora when we first bought. One weekend, I remember coming and my mom started telling a story about them going to the local hardware store. And that this young man had come up to my dad and given him a hug and said, "Mr. Diaz, how are you doing?" And my dad had no clue who he was, but he played along and the guy sat there and told him, "Man, I remember all that you did for me. I so appreciate it. It changed my life. I'd be in debt or in jail if it weren't for you." And my mom finished the story. And I looked at my dad and I said, "Bob, who is that?" "You know, just one of those kids from down there." What he meant by one of those kids from down there was one of the kids at Taft Homes, the projects just down the street from our home. When I was a kid, my dad used to take his little pickup truck and he'd go through Taft Homes in the neighborhood and he'd pick up kids and we'd go to football practice. And on Saturdays, he'd pick up the kids and we'd go play our games. And afterwards, win or lose, we ended up at the ice cream shack. And it was my dad giving those kids an opportunity to be part of a community that they were forgotten in. And he didn't do this for accolades or anything else. He did it because that's what you do for community. And I'll be honest, my dad didn't speak a lot of English back then, and it wasn't the best, so it's not like he was talking to every kid, but every kid saw him as a father figure that was present in their lives. So it boosted my own pride in my dad and in what he had done, and it highlighted how the little things can make the greatest impact in our community. When my parents came back to the store a couple weeks later, the manager grabbed them and said, "Hey, thank you. That kid wouldn't shut up that afternoon, but you guys made a difference." He gave them a discount. They bought some new cabinets. Life is good. But it was one of those things. It wasn't done for that. It was done because of the care for our community. Then a few weeks later, we were walking out of my parents' house, and next door, there was a for sale sign. The house that it was in front of is a beautiful little brick cottage, wraparound porch, slate roof, huge yard, just absolutely beautiful. I look at my wife and I say, "Gosh, we gotta go look at that place." She burst into tears. I said, "Honey, it's okay. I lived with my parents for 17 years. They're not that bad. We're just gonna be neighbors." She said, "No, it's not that. It's that I haven't felt at home where we were at." 1 year in, she too felt that pull that we weren't in the right place and that we weren't making a difference in our community. We weren't engaged. We dreamt of doing something and being somewhere where we could make a difference. By the end of that week, we had a deal to move into that house. And as Dave Ramsey says, we were prepared to live like no one else, so in the future, we could live like no one else. For me, it was great to be back in the neighborhood. This was just 4 years ago. And as we got settled into the house, I was driving through the neighborhood, and in front of the house that I grew up in, just three blocks from where I live today and where my parents are, was an excavator, a Caterpillar excavator at that, and a sign marking the property for demolition. I called my parents and I said, "Did you see this? They're gonna tear down our old house." My mom said, "Yeah, the people we sold it to back then, they had some issues, the pipes burst, it was damaged beyond repair, and so they walked away." I started to look into it a little bit, and I realized that the lots surrounding that house, or where that house sits, was, were available through the county auction. And so I told my wife, I said, "Honey, for $600, we can own all the lots around my old house. And if we wait long enough, we can have that place too." Now, if you could believe, right, sure as I'm standing here, that my wife was excited like I was, you'd be wrong. She thought I was nuts. But she knew that I had a dream and I had a vision. And I explained to her that my goal was to just do it so that we had it, that land, and that me and my dad could start on a garden like we had when I was a kid. And we could grow some little place, and it's near us and it's in the neighborhood, and that he and I could spend some time together, but also that my kids could join us in the summer and have some of that family time and build up our family together, bonding over growing a garden. It was very prescient that we did it at that time. We started planning for a garden for the spring. We picked up the empty lots. And in January, Kroger had announced that they were shutting down some of their local grocery stores. One of them in particular was just there 3 minutes from our house up the hill. So we started to talk about grander visions for this garden because we couldn't just grow something for us, but we wanted to do something to benefit our community. So we ordered 20 tons of compost. We put together a plan and we started growing that garden in the spring. And in we started what was called Urban Acres with the idea that the land we lived on plus these lots was just over 2 acres and what kind of difference we could be in our community. And at some point that as a business that we could help benefit the town. So I picked up some more land around the area and I had a dream of opening a farm stand right across from one of the local parks where all the people come out and play soccer and basketball during the summer. There was one lot I didn't own and it was owned by the city. So I approached them and you can imagine the angst, anger, and just disgust that I had with our city government when they told me, thanks, but no thanks. You're not rich enough. You're not good enough to do development in our city. We'll pass. I was devastated, kind of broken. I started planning on what could we do next because I knew that I was destined to make a difference in our community. One night as I was driving away from our house, I turned the corner and there was a commercial building right around the corner from us with a for sale sign. I immediately called our friend, a realtor there in Peoria, and I said, Mary, give me all the information on this place and what do they want for it? Andy, that's not for sale. And I said, Mary, by God, it is. There's a for sale sign out front. She does a little bit of digging and she says, well, that listing's not active yet. She called the agent and she gave me all the facts and statistics. And we had been living like no one else for moments like this because we were prepared to then make an investment back into our community. So 2 years ago, we bought the building around the corner from us that had this great big parking lot with the idea that we had a place now to sell our produce, to get it into the community and not just be selling it from our front porch or driving through the neighborhood trying to find someone to benefit from all of the produce we were growing. The first year of Urban Acres, we grew just over 1,000 pounds of produce. This year, we were at 3,000 pounds of produce. And it was a matter of getting it into the community, into the people's hands that needed it, whether it was selling it, whether it was donating it through our church, or just when people came along and said, hey, I really like some tomatoes, but I don't have any money. And putting it in their hands and knowing that they were gonna enjoy fresh produce. And at that same time when we bought the building, we started this eclectic group of people. I put out a call on Facebook and I invited our neighbors and Peorians to come and check out Urban Acres and the new Springboard Market. We had a small group show up on a Saturday and I told them this vision that we were gonna go from just having gardens to starting a farmer's market. One of the women from the neighborhood sells a lot of wind chimes and hair bows and different things like that on Etsy. And she said, Andy, I do really good business on there. I don't know that I'll do anything over here, but I love your vision. I want to be part of something bigger. Can I come down and set up with you? I said, yes, Sherry, please. A woman just one block down the street, she goes, hey, Andy, I sell plants online. Can I come sell over there? I said, yeah, come on. And a friend of mine at work, her sister makes tie-dye t-shirts. She said, hey, Andy, can Cindy come over and sell t-shirts at your market? I said, tie-dye t-shirts? Yeah, I guess. If she thinks she'll sell them, bring it on. And then a couple from the neighborhood actually sells tacos at different fairs and events, and they said, hey, we'll come sell food every Saturday if you'll let us. So this eclectic group of people came together on the corner of Spring and Monroe every Saturday to sell their goods and to be part of a bigger thing, to be in community, and to try to convince people to stop and shop locally. Over the last couple of years, we've actually grown that from the first 4 eclectic group to this year having a waiting list of people wanting to come in and be part of what we were doing. It's not just a farmer's market. Because we're present, because we hear people, we listen and talk to each other. We share stories of what happened during the week. We laugh at the people that maybe have come down and bought something and the stories they have to tell. We're a community. In the last couple of years, I have not seen this kind of engagement in our neighborhood, well, since I was a kid. Friendships have been built, and there's this idea that we're doing something more. And let me tell you, if you'd have told me that tie-dye t-shirts would be the best seller in my market, I'd have laughed you out of the building. But every weekend, our friend Cindy comes down and kills it. She sells more tie-dye t-shirts at the North Valley Farmers Market than she did at the riverfront that she's done at Spoon River Drive or any other market around. So it just makes me laugh at the people and the things that we can do when we don't put boundaries and limits, and we welcome everyone to the table to be part of the conversation and to sell their goods or to at least try something out. And we do it all because that's our neighborhood. That's our heart and our spirit. This year, we actually had an accountant come in and rent space from us in the Springboard Market. He came and set up, and because he spoke Spanish in a neighborhood that's 20% Latino, he killed it. We are helping a thriving economy. And our plan is for the second act is to have a commissary or a commercial kitchen within that facility. So as we plan for the winter and come into the spring, we can be invested in others and not just ourselves. Now that brings us to the current day, as the name of the lecture is From Gardens to Government. Well, in the last few years, as we've talked to our friends and our neighbors, and as I alluded to earlier, government wasn't working. We heard from people that felt the same as us, that people at City Hall and the people leading our city weren't interested in hearing from folks making change, or at least not small change. They wanted to bet on the big dogs, million-dollar deals. And it's just not the way it works. In the last couple of years, I have been blessed to be covered not only in our local newspaper, but made connections with a group called Strong Towns. It's a national movement from a bottom-up mentality that incremental change is what will help our communities around the country survive the next industrial revolution and technological revolution. It's those small changes that we live by in doing what we do. And it's the idea behind my own involvement and engagement with the residents of Peoria, the residents of my neighborhood, to ask them what's best for them. What is their idea to help change our community? To listen and then put into action what they're asking for. Because citizenship as a relationship requires both sides to fulfill a promise to each other. It's why I entered the race for mayor, because sometimes, in my perspective, we failed at coming to the table together. Sadly, when we don't allow everyone to contribute, it's like not having all the members of the orchestra present for a concert. Sure, you still hear music, but it's not nearly as rich, nor as deep. You miss an integral part of the music and the story without the full ensemble. And that's my drive, is to make sure from the piccolo to the bass, we have all of it present in our conversations. With my experience in government, my work at the Planning Commission, and then 16 years of selling equipment for Caterpillar, I was selling to state and local agencies, and now to federal agencies and foreign governments around the world. I have a unique understanding and perspective. From my perspective of growing up in the hood as a Latino, as the other, to being part of a Fortune 50 company and being part of an in crowd. And a lot of what I see in my perspective is that we are lacking vision and leadership in our communities. We don't dream about getting greatness and about what we can accomplish. We don't harness the power of average citizens. If anything, we resist those that want to make a difference. And it has to change. When I jumped into the race a few months ago, I've got to say, it was a lot like walking into fourth grade again. I wasn't sure that I belonged. But I know with 42 years of life experience, dinner with multimillionaires, drinks with dozer operators, conversations with those experiencing homelessness, that we all strive just to be heard, and that we can all be a part of the greater orchestra. I know that each of those people is no different than I. They have stories like my own, and I want to bring that to the forefront. I've been introduced over the last few weeks to people from executive offices and leadership positions within our community to factory and retail workers, all of them having unique perspectives and their own part to play in the symphony. We're living in a time when people question citizenship, motive, political leanings, and it's destructive to our cohesion as a people. At the municipal level, we're neighbors, we're friends, we're coworkers. We can disagree on implementing a plan, but we don't have to be disagreeable, because each of us started somewhere with a perspective and a background that people have to take the time to hear, listen, and appreciate to understand where you're coming from. And we have to accept everyone at the table and hear those stories if we will progress in the future. And now I look at it and I think, what is citizenship to a college student, to a Eureka College student? How can you challenge yourself this evening or as you leave this place to take part in your community? Because it's about engagement. It's about being part of something grander than yourself. Now, I don't expect anyone to go run for mayor the first thing out of the gate. As I told my story, we started small. I started fixing bikes for the kids in the neighborhood because I saw the need. We started the idea of a small garden for our family and took it to the next level because that was the opportunity that presented itself to us. We didn't do it all at once. We continue to grow and evolve. We continue to listen to our friends, to change how we're doing things because more people have come along and they've given us their expertise, their knowledge, their friendship. Because when you're part of a community, when you are using your citizenship, you build deep bonds with your neighbors, with strangers that you meet at the local farmers market, to change the community that you're in. So whether it's student body politics, the local club or organization that you're a part of here at school, or just holding up a sign on the corner, spreading your message of change, I challenge you to do some of this action, to use your citizenship, to push your own personal boundaries, and expectations of others and yourself. Learn to rock the boat without capsizing and inspire others to offer their best and be the citizens that give back into the system from which you're benefiting. I appreciate y'all's attention and the group here tonight. Through COVID and everything else, I know it's crazy times. But together, we can change our own parts of the world, and we can make a difference in our community and take it to a national level. Thank you.
I have questions.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. I was just going to say we have time for Q&A if people want to unmute themselves and ask through the owl or people in the room. We can move back and forth.
So first of all, thank you for that. We have, my first thing is just a comment. All of our freshmen or first year students here take a justice and civic responsibility course. So I think, Annie, we'll get this recording to all those faculty because I think it will fit into some of those courses. You might become somebody's homework.
or a
lecture one day. Because that's great. That fits right into what we're talking about. I'm going to thank you for your citizenship, but I want to go back to that part of your little speech that you glossed over, those 10 years of college.
Yeah.
We have a lot of students here who are, their claim to fame is also that they will be the first in their families to earn a college degree. And they probably arrive on our campus and don't quite feel like they belong either. So do you have advice for them? Do you have tips for them?
Well, that's why I made the joke about perseverance, but it really is when it's not part of your culture to go to college, when it's, my parents beat it into our heads that we were going to be better than them. I went as a full ride student to Iowa State right out of high school. And it was shocking. I mean, everything for me was eye-opening along the way coming from my worldview. And so to those others that maybe it's not part of your culture, it's not part of your family history, there's no right or wrong, right? But you have to persevere and you have to be willing to be uncomfortable for a while.
Mm-hmm.
And recognize sometimes that the path you're on may require a detour. So mine had multiple detours along the way. But I think if you find someone, and this is advice I've given to other college students, is go and sit near the front of the class. Say hi to the teacher, befriend the teacher so they know who you are. So when you miss class, they're actually concerned about where you're at because you're always there. Or when you're not there, you tell them, hey, I'm not gonna be here Tuesday because I've got this big exam and I've really got to study or whatever. Because your teachers are human too, right? And I didn't know that. And I didn't have someone give me that advice, right, when I was a kid. So I think if you take that approach, that sometimes that can help you get over that first year where you're in a new setting, you're overwhelmed, you're self-responsible, right? You've got to wake up and do all that. But you've got to persevere and you've got to see that at the end of the day, that it is a point of pride. And whether your parents push you for it, or whether you push for it internally, when you have that piece of paper, the amount of respect that you can garner, because people will say, man, that guy put in his time and maybe he couldn't afford it, maybe he's the first, whatever, but that it is something proudly to display that you've completed that college degree. So I know it's kind of a long answer, but it's to persevere, to find a mentor, to find somebody, whether it's a peer or a teacher, that will kick you in the butt and tell you, get back to work, suck it up, pat you on the back when you're sad, but that doesn't tell you it's okay to quit, because it's never okay to quit. You might find a detour. You might have other priorities come up. But it's never okay to just quit.
Thank you.
Other questions, either in the room or people on Zoom?
How many of your dad's 11 siblings stayed in Mexico?
So 8 are still in Mexico.
8.
Yeah, we've got 2 here in the U.S. And I think we're all like that, right? Like,
yeah.
For us, it's a connection back home.
Mm-hmm.
And it's been the biggest thing for my wife and I to be able to go back and mm-hmm. for her to experience that family.
Right.
It's kept us grounded because I think it's very easy that if everyone would have come here, we would have dispersed. And I see it on my mom's side.
Right.
All of her siblings are here in the U.S., across the country, and there's not that same familial connection that we have when we go back, and everybody's in the same small village. I mean, I think it's, at this point, I think they're up to about 10,000 people in their village. So it's very, it's very culturally relevant that I think is American. Sometimes we have this diaspora that you go off and you make your own way and you forget that family history. For us, it's been shown to us year after year. And it's the proudest thing I have in my life.
So Robert says on Zoom, I can attest to that because I was in a horrific car accident in my second year of community college. And I am so proud that I'm still going to school pursuing a career.
There you go. Good work, Robert.
Also from Dr. Everett, he's signing off, but I want to say thank you. And that you'd love to share this recording with all our students and that. Well, you're an amazing human being. I'm not making that up. That's what she actually said.
No. I thank you all. It's very humbling to be invited to do something like this. And thank you.
Yeah. Well, thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Campus. Have a nice night, everyone. Robert, keep it up. He's still on. Keep it up. And get that career going, man.